What does anybody want to assassinate me for? If anyone wants to do so, he can do it any day or night, if he is ready to give his life for mine. It is nonsense. It was Abraham Lincoln who said that. The murder of a president, the murder of his alleged murderer, no one can yet evaluate these acts. In quieter times, historians will make their evaluation of what all this means. What we do know now is that one president succeeds another, that America goes on, that the death of one man, however high in station, cannot stop the momentum of this nation. One man died, but 190 million Americans live. The country goes on, the presidency goes on. The crazed man who slew the president did not kill America or the presidency. He killed John Fitzgerald Kennedy. Perhaps 20 or 100 years from now, we will know exactly what America has lost. More probably, we will never quite know. There is no use trying to talk reasonably about assassination. Reasonable men, however much they may differ in their opinions, do not murder one another. In the history of America, 4 of 36 presidents have been assassinated. Abraham Lincoln, James Garfield, William McKinley, John Kennedy. Unsuccessful assassination attempts were made against Andrew Jackson, Theodore Roosevelt, Franklin Roosevelt, and Harry Truman. These are the men who attempted to kill a president of the United States. Richard Lawrence tried to kill President Andrew Jackson. He was undoubtedly mad. Among other delusions, he called himself King Richard III of England and America, since he believed that the United States in 1835 was still a British possession. He had been politically inflamed by some of the strong anti-Jackson speeches in Washington, but his actions reflected no group or party. At a distance of 13 feet from President Jackson, Lawrence pulled the trigger of his first pistol, which misfired and dropped. President Jackson then charged his would-be killer. As the president came within 1 foot of Richard Lawrence, the madman fired again, but the second pistol also failed. There was an attempt to lynch this assassin, but the case did go to trial. Lawrence was defended by Francis Scott Key, who wrote The Star-Spangled Banner. Key claimed that his client was insane, a claim that was supported by Lawrence's own behavior. Lawrence said that the court was not qualified to try him. He said, "I claim the crown of the United States, likewise the crown of Great Britain, and I am superior to this court." He was imprisoned for life. Charles Julius Guiteau was an evangelist, an insurance salesman, a lawyer, author, and publisher. In 1880, he campaigned vigorously for the election of James Garfield, who was to become the 20th president of the United States. Guiteau wrote a political pamphlet which he felt was a decisive factor in Garfield's election. Guiteau expected to be named either ambassador to Austria or to become consul in Paris. He was a religious fanatic who was, in his own words, in the employ of Jesus Christ and Company, the very ablest and strongest firm in the universe. At one time, he also believed himself to be the prime minister of Britain. Guiteau purchased an elegant pistol in a Washington store in June of 1881, the best one he could find so that it would look good in a museum. On June 12th, he had an opportunity to shoot President Garfield in a church. Guiteau later said that he could not think of a better place to shoot a scoundrel, but decided against it because he might injure somebody else. On July 2nd, at a Washington railway depot, Guiteau strolled up to the President of the U.S. and shot him in the back. The people in the station made a move to lynch Guiteau, but he was taken to prison, where he started a new book called The Life and Theology of Charles Guiteau, prepared by himself. He was tried 5 months after the assassination. The atmosphere was feverish. One of Guiteau's guards attempted to kill the assassin through the window of his cell. While being transferred from jail to court, Guiteau was fired at by a drunk who missed him. In the courtroom, Guiteau said, "I come here in the capacity of an agent of the deity in this matter." His defense was insanity. After 1 hour and 5 minutes of deliberation, the jury found him sane and guilty. He was hanged before a crowd of people, some of whom paid $300 for the privilege of seeing the execution. He went to his death mumbling religious doggerel that he had written in jail. On Friday, September 6, 1901, Leon Czolgosz shot President William McKinley. Czolgosz was an anarchist who suffered a profound mental breakdown 3 years before he killed the president. But he had received neither diagnosis nor treatment. He purchased a pistol in a store in Buffalo, New York. This is a photograph taken just 15 minutes before the shooting. President McKinley awaiting the public in a reception line. A few feet away, Zolgos waited with a handkerchief thrown over the pistol as if it were a bandage. At one point, he wandered out of line, but a guard pushed him back. When the assassin reached him, McKinley offered his right hand. Zolgos pushed it aside with his left hand and fired twice at the president. Zolgos was kicked and beaten, almost bayoneted. He was later searched. In addition to the usual personal effect, a rubber baby's nipple was found in his pockets. Zolgos' trial was brief. He had no defense attorneys until 2 days before the trial. The defendant refused to take an interest in the proceedings. He did not take the stand on his own behalf. His attorneys did not plead insanity. He was electrocuted. His last words were, "I killed the president because he was the enemy of the good people, the good working people. I am not sorry for my crime." After the death of President McKinley, the Secret Service took full responsibility for guarding the president's life. And between September 6, 1901 and November 22, 1963, no president was killed. But attempts were made at three different times. In 1912, Theodore Roosevelt was no longer the president and was no longer defended by the Secret Service. But Teddy Roosevelt was an announced candidate for a third term. In the same year, one John Schrank purchased a pistol in New York for $14. Schrank was a sometime drunk who considered Roosevelt a dangerous radical for aspiring to a third term. For a period of 24 days, Schrank followed the campaigning Roosevelt through more than 2,000 miles of travel. On October 13th in Milwaukee, from a distance of 6 feet, Schrank shot at the former president. Now, Roosevelt had a 100-page manuscript in his breast pocket along with his eyeglass case. The bullet was slowed, but it penetrated the president's body. Though his face was covered with blood, Teddy Roosevelt continued his speech. Schrank received a fair trial. Two of his letters were introduced in evidence. This one dated September 15, 1912. It said, "To the people of the United States, September 15, 1901, 1:30 a.m., in a dream I saw President McKinley sit up in his coffin pointing at a man in monk's attire, in whom I recognized Theodore Roosevelt. The dead president said, 'This is my murderer, avenge my death.'" Another note from Schrank, "To prevent is better than to defend. Never let a third-term party emblem appear on an official ballot. I am willing to die for my country. God has called me to be his instrument, so help me God. Ein fester Berg ist unser Gott. God is a mighty fortress." Schrank was declared insane and spent the rest of his life in prison. In 1933, Giuseppe Zangara was 32 years old. He had duodenal ulcers and a pistol he had bought for $8 in a pawn shop in Miami. In 1922, while in Italy, he had bought another weapon. At that time, he had thought about killing King Victor Emmanuel III. 2 years later, he thought he might kill President Calvin Coolidge, but nothing came of this. In the winter of 1932, Herbert Hoover was president, and Zangara had almost decided to go to Washington to shoot the 31st president. Zangara was in Miami at the time. Unfortunately, so was Franklin Delano Roosevelt, the president-elect, and Mayor Cermak of Chicago. Zangara rather admired Roosevelt. Though he was hostile to capitalism, Zangara was not a communist or a fascist or a socialist. He had registered as a Republican, but in his testimony he said, "The capitalists get to be boss to my father, keep the money from my father, and my father send me to work, and I have no school, and I have trouble with my stomach. And that way I make my idea to kill the president, kill any president, any king." When President Roosevelt arrived in Miami, he was to go to an outdoor theater on Biscayne Bay. Zangara planned to take a seat in the front row, but he arrived late and could see little but the backs of the people who had arrived before him. These underexposed films show Roosevelt arriving at the outdoor theater. Zangara is on the right side of the screen. The people on the right are standing on their chairs, in effect shielding the president from the assassin. The newsreel cameramen were in the wrong position. They are photographing the president's back. So a newsman is sent to the president, asking him to turn around and repeat this statement. As Roosevelt is handed the microphone by the man in the white suit, the president-elect stands, but Zangara still cannot get his shot.
"Friends of Miami, I am not a stranger here. Because for a good many years I used to come down here. I haven't been here for 7 years. But on my coming back, I have firmly resolved not to make it the last time." and to see all of you, and to have another wonderful 10 days or 2 weeks in Florida waters. Many thanks.
If Roosevelt had remained standing, he would probably have been killed. At this moment, with the speech clearly over, Roosevelt waves, smiles his famous smile, and the people in front of Zangara begin to go home. The motorcycle engine started up, and Zangara cut loose with 5 wild shots. Mayor Cermak of Chicago was hit. Roosevelt insisted that the car be stopped, and the president carried the mayor to the hospital in his car. But Anton Cermak died 3 weeks later. Zangara was tried twice, once before Cermak died and once afterwards. His legal defense did not include insanity. A member of the Sanity Commission later said that medically Zangara was not sane. Legally, at the time, he was sane. He was electrocuted. He was enraged because no photographers were present to see him die. He said, "No picture, no one here to take my picture, all capitalist lousy bunch of crooks." Richard Lawrence. Charles Guiteau. Leon Czolgosz. John Schrank, Giuseppe Zangara. All these assassins were insane. None of them made the slightest plan to escape. All worked alone. All had no trouble buying guns over a counter. None had accomplices. None plotted with anyone else. In all the history of our country, there have been only 2 instances of organized group plots to assassinate American presidents. Assassination conspiracies are better known in Asia, the Near East, or South America than in Europe and the U.S. On November 1st, 1950, 2 Puerto Ricans, Oscar Colazzo and Griselio Torresola, attempted to kill President Harry Truman. Colazzo and Torresola were fanatical members of the small and insignificant Puerto Rican nationalist movement whose purpose was total independence for Puerto Rico, a territory of this country. Hoping to dramatize the need for Puerto Rican independence, Colazzo and Torresola timed their attack on the president to coincide with a full-scale attack on the local government in Puerto Rico. In Puerto Rico, the tiny nationalist movement, numbering less than 1,000 members, wanted power. Their method of attaining it was violence. 2 days before the attempt on President Truman's life, 5 nationalists attacked the palace of the governor of Puerto Rico and tried to kill him. Others bombed police stations and burned public buildings. At least 32 people lost their lives, but government troops put down the revolt easily. Oscar Colazzo was an intellectual who never went farther than the 8th grade of public school, but he had read American and South American history intensively. He later taught himself Latin and read Cicero. Griselio Torresola was married or had lived with a number of women. He was an expert gunman. Both men came from Puerto Rico to the slums of the west side of New York. Whatever their connection may have been to the Puerto Rican nationalist movement, they were appalled by the status of the Puerto Rican in continental America. Colazzo believed that the United States was a colonist nation which exploited Puerto Ricans in their native island and gave Puerto Ricans in New York only the lowest rung on the social and economic ladder. If there was beauty in America, Colazzo saw none of it in the West Side slums of New York. In 1950, the White House was undergoing extensive renovation. Only the facade of the building was standing. Behind the outer walls, the building had been scooped out and was being entirely rebuilt. President Truman and his family had moved to the Blair House, a government building across the street used to accommodate visiting dignitaries. Colazzo arrived in Washington with a new suit, bought because, in his words, a man wanted to look nice when he went away on a trip. As part of his luggage, Torresola had a recently purchased Luger pistol. He bought a P-38 automatic pistol for $35 and gave that to Colazzo. In a hotel room in Washington, Torresola tried to teach Colazzo how to use the weapon. There are a number of safety catches on this pistol. Colazzo, the intellectual, did not learn the basic steps needed to prepare the weapon for firing. When he fired first at a guard, he did not disengage the safety lock. The gun clicked instead of firing, and the guard was alerted. Their plan was simply to shoot their way into Blair House, find President Truman, and kill him. Altogether, Colazzo got off 9 shots, one of which struck a policeman in the leg. Torresola's marksmanship was better. He killed one guard, wounded another. but while reloading, he was killed by a guard whom he had mortally wounded. Colazzo, badly wounded, lay on the sidewalk. A few minutes later, he was moved to a nearby hospital, and he was placed under heavy guard. Colazzo's blood was washed off the pavement. President Truman then went to his office in the White House. He continued his daily walks, and although the Secret Service tried to tighten security around him, the president said he had no intention of changing his habits. Mr. Truman said that the risks simply had to be taken. Colazzo refused to permit his attorneys to enter a defense of insanity. He thought that would disgrace the movement he represented. He also refused to ask the president for clemency because it would discredit the nationalist cause. Nevertheless, President Truman later reduced the sentence from execution to life imprisonment. The assassination of President Truman was aimed at terrorizing America into granting Puerto Rican independence. The result of the attempt was completely the opposite. Puerto Ricans drew closer to America, and the nationalist movement is almost now non-existent. The greatest assassination plot in American history occurred in 1865. Its beginnings were in 1861, when the actor John Wilkes Booth first saw Abraham Lincoln. Booth was a snob, conscious of his good looks, much aware of how well he dressed. When he first saw Lincoln, Booth said, "This man's appearance, his pedigree, his coarse, low jokes and anecdotes, his vulgar similes and his frivolity are a disgrace to the seat he holds." The animal antagonism that Booth felt for Lincoln gradually became cloaked in theatrical and political terms. Booth, the actor, was a drunk who had had many affairs with many different women. His political ideas were only half-shaped. They centered themselves on the cause of the Confederacy, though when invited to join the Confederate Army, Booth declined. He could aid the South better, he said, with his money than with his arms. By 1863, drink had so impaired his voice that his acting began to suffer. In 1864, General Grant stopped the exchange of Southern prisoners for the Northern prisoners. It was at this moment that Booth seized on the idea of capturing the president and holding him hostage till the exchange of prisoners recommenced. In September of 64, Booth began the clandestine job of recruiting a gang to help him with the kidnapping. David Harold, an unemployed clerk with the mentality of an 11-year-old, was enlisted. George A. Atzerodt, a blockade runner, carriage painter, and black marketeer. Michael O'Loughlin, Confederate Army deserter in the produce business. Louis Payne, son of a minister, a Confederate soldier captured at Gettysburg. His physique was magnificent, his intelligence of a low order. Samuel Arnold, a discharged Confederate soldier and occasional farm worker. John Surratt, Jr., a Confederate spy and a clerk in Washington. Surratt's mother, Mary Eugenia Surratt. History has never discovered her exact role in the conspiracy. Edward Spangler, a drunk, carpenter, and crab fisherman. His precise plot and part in the plot has also never been exactly explained. But the center of the group was Booth. There is no evidence that he was ever supported in any manner by the organized forces of the Confederacy. A man of elegance, Booth obviously disdained the ragged group that he had collected around him. He tried to recruit two actors, both refused, but neither informed the authorities. As his acting talent began to fade, Booth found a symbolic parallel in the fading fortunes of the Confederacy. It became evident to Booth that his original plot, that of kidnapping the president to force an exchange of prisoners, was neither dramatic enough for his personal taste, nor of enough consequence to turn the tide of the war. On April 9th, 1865, Lee surrendered to Grant at Appomattox. On April 11th, Booth was on the White House lawn to hear Lincoln deliver a speech about the Union's plans to restore peace to the South. On April 14, Booth went to a converted Baptist church named Ford's Theater, ostensibly to pick up his mail. But sometime that day, he drilled a small hole in the door behind the box which the president and his party were to occupy. Booth's goal was no longer kidnapping, but assassination, and not only of Lincoln. His accomplices were assigned their murders as well. Atzerodt was to kill Vice President Johnson. But Atzerodt was shocked at the change in plans, and he refused. Though he knew all the details of the plot, he did nothing except drink himself into a stupor. And Vice President Johnson was left unharmed. Secretary of State Seward was to be another target. His killing was assigned to Lewis Payne. Payne gained access to Seward's home by pretending to deliver medicine. He attacked Seward's son. He rushed into the bedroom and stabbed the Secretary of State several times, then raced downstairs crying, "I'm mad, I'm mad." Seward later recovered. Abraham Lincoln had always enjoyed going to the theater. During the war years, to escape the pressures of the White House, he'd often gone, unannounced, to many theaters in Washington. He would slip into a seat and stay for a few minutes or an hour. But his visit to Ford Theater on the night of April 14th was expected. The president had been given a bodyguard, John F. Parker. Parker had once been court-martialed for being drunk and disorderly in a house of prostitution. Once Lincoln had entered the box at Ford's Theater, Parker simply left his post and went to the nearest saloon where he got drunk. The play was Our American Cousin. It was not a good play, even in Lincoln's time, and the president had seen it before. But he didn't mind sitting through it again. Booth came to the rear of the president's box with a single shot, 8-ounce brass Derringer pistol. He fired. The bullet struck the president in the head. He never knew what hit him. And Booth, true to his theatrical instincts, shouted a line from the box, "Sic semper tyrannis, thus ever to tyrants." Booth had often rewritten his own stage entrances to include a leap. Once, while playing Richard III, he had written in a leap and had ordered a springboard to catapult him on stage. After shooting Lincoln, Booth leapt to the stage but broke his leg. He had stationed a horse outside and he galloped away into the night. Lincoln was carried across the street into a small house. This is a small bedroom in which Lincoln died. As the Lincoln legends grew, this bedroom was too small to accommodate all the people who were supposed to be in it as Lincoln died. Later, drawings show as many as 45 people in the room. This one shows 26. Booth holed up in a barn in Maryland. He wrote in his diary during his last hours a statement consistent with his own image of himself as an actor and a statesman. He said, "I am hunted like a dog, and why? For doing what Brutus was honored for, what made William Tell a hero, and yet I, for striking down a greater tyrant, am looked upon as a common cutthroat. I have too great a soul to die like a criminal." At 2 o'clock in the morning of April 26, soldiers surrounded the barn where he was hiding. Their orders were not to shoot, but to take Booth alive. Booth refused to come out. The barn was set afire. History is not clear whether Booth shot himself, but a soldier present said later that he had killed Booth on orders from the Almighty. As for the other conspirators, Mrs. Surratt, David Harold, Lewis Payne, George Atzerodt, they were hanged. And there's been a strong feeling that Mrs. Surratt's sentence was unjust. But the decision of the military court was not reversed by President Johnson. Booth's last words were useless, useless. Not only useless to kill a president, but to assume that in any large way history will record or remember the man who did it. The names of the assassins are objects of minor notations in most history books. No historian, no playwright, no country has ever honored or respected the assassin. Distaste, revulsion, near anonymity have been the perpetual shroud of those who would kill for whatever imagined cause. The assassins we have talked about are the refuge and the garbage of history. All those assassins were men tortured and consumed by hatred. They hated life and society. Perhaps at bottom they hated themselves. They struck at the head and chief symbol of society to fulfill their own sick selves, to give their meaningless lives some kind of meaning. Perhaps it's fruitless to blame society as a whole. Such men have existed and acted in all types of society. Lee Harvey Oswald of Dallas, Texas, was like John Wilkes Booth and unlike the others in certain respects. He tried to escape the consequences of his alleged act, and like Booth, he never came to trial. The violent act of each one set off further violence. After Lincoln's death, violence and violent feelings spread deep in this country. Retribution and counter-retribution took many forms. And it is this that must not happen now after President Kennedy's death, as Chief Justice Warren warned us yesterday when he spoke beside the president's coffin. Violence can beget violence, but calm also begets calm. The days immediately ahead, therefore, will place us all on a kind of trial. A country will be on trial before a doubting world which wonders if the United States is qualified to act as a leader in the effort to bring law, stability, and peace to other countries. Deep strains of violence in our society and perhaps in our American nature have come to the surface in recent months. Hardly a day has passed that legal force has not been required to restrain illegal force on some street in some town. To anyone now listening who may have murder in his heart, the brief scanning of history shown in this last half hour has something else to say. Political murder is one crime that does not pay in America. Assassins and would-be assassins are always caught. The result expected by the assassin never comes. The effects are always the opposite of what the murderer has in mind. John Wilkes Booth damaged the Southern cause by his act. If Lee Oswald, the alleged killer of Mr. Kennedy, had any thought of aiding communism or Cuba or Russia, he has pretty surely accomplished the reverse. White men who shoot or bomb Negroes hasten the end of white supremacy. Negroes who kill white men delay the time of Negro equality in their community. In countries where personal rule is the tradition, murder can and does change governments, policies, whole social structures. But it cannot do so in a country that lives under the rule of law. The overwhelming instinct of most citizens is to band closer together and to seek their protection behind the law, not behind a gun. That is the reason we have a government of law, not of men. No bullet can strike down the law. This is Eric Severide. Good night.
This is the CBS Television Network.